Lord, as we celebrate the feast day in honour of all the saints, at whose festival the angels rejoice and praise the Son of God. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit, Amen. The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Welcome on this special day, the Feast of All Saints, one of the great feast days in the Church's calendar, and one which sometimes in the past has been overlooked. But here in London, we celebrate in its entirety. And so we come into God's presence. We open our hearts before Him. Christ has won victory over death, a victory in which we all share. Let us acknowledge our sinfulness to the Lord, knowing He wipes every tear from our eyes.
You are sent to heal the contrite of heart. Lord, have mercy.
Lord, have mercy.
You came to call sinners. Christ, have mercy.
Christ, have mercy.
You are seated at the right hand of the Father.
Lord, have mercy.
together your elect in one communion and fellowship in the mystical body of your Son, Christ our Lord. Grant us grace so to follow your blessed saints in all virtuous and godly living, that we may come to those inexpressible joys that you have prepared for those who truly love you. Through Jesus Christ, your Son, our Lord, who is alive and reigns with you in the unity of the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever.
Amen.
Would you please sit for our Bible?
A reading from the Book of Wisdom. The souls of the righteous are in the hands of God, and no torment will ever touch them. In the eyes of the foolish, they seem to have died, and their departure was thought to be a disaster. And they go from us to be their destruction, but they are at peace. For though in the sight of others they were punished, their hope is full of immortality. Having been disciplined a little, they will receive great good, because God tested them and found them worthy of himself. Like gold in the furnace, he tried them, and like a sacrificial burnt offering, he accepted them. In the time of their visitation, they will shine forth and will run like sparks through the stubble. They will govern nations and rule over peoples, and the Lord will reign over them forever. Those who trust in him will understand truth, and the faithful will abide with him in love, because grace and mercy are upon his holy ones, and he watches over his elect. This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Thank you.
hear the Gospel of our Lord Jesus Christ according to John.
Glory to you, O Lord.
When Mary came to where Jesus was and saw him, she knelt at his feet and said to him, Lord, if you had been here, my brother would not have died. When Jesus saw her weeping, and the Jews who came with her also weeping, he was greatly disturbed in spirit and deeply moved. He said, Where have you laid him? They said to him, Lord, come and see. Jesus began to weep. So the Jews said, See how he loved him. But some of them said, Could not he who opened the eyes of the blind have kept this man from dying? Then Jesus, again greatly disturbed, came to the tomb. It was a cave, and a stone was lying against it. Jesus said, Take away the stone. Martha, the sister of the dead man, said to him, Lord, already there is a stench because he has been dead 4 days. Jesus said to her, Did I not tell you that if you believed, you would see the glory of God? So they took away the stone. And Jesus looked upward and said, Father, I thank you for having heard me. I knew that you always hear me, but have said this for the sake of the crowd standing here, so that they may believe that you sent me. When he said this, he cried with a loud voice, Lazarus, come out. The dead man came out, his hands and feet bound with strips of cloth, and his face wrapped in a cloth. Jesus said to them, Unbind him and let him go. This is the Gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, Lord Christ.
In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. Would you please sit? It occurred to me that there is a sense almost of appropriateness that many of us here were in church on Friday to bid farewell to our former and long-standing church warden, Rosemary, and to commend her to God's keeping. And today we've returned to celebrate the Feast of All Saints. We can take comfort, I think, from our Bible readings, which have an eschatological flavour about them. I love that word. Eschatological. What a comfort we get from the reading from the Wisdom of Solomon. The souls of the righteous are in the hands of God, and no torment will ever touch them. This is the theology that we call eschatology. You can use that word now on your friends, can't you? Or, you know, when you're ordering coffee, perhaps in Dobby's, to one of the assistants, just say, Is this coffee eschatological? And see what response you get. But it is, of course, the theology of death and judgment and the final destiny of the soul, and indeed of all humankind. And even though it is eschatological, see, I'm trying to get it in as many times as I can, can't you? It still can lead us to underestimate the significance of the saints. The Feast of All Saints used to be considered to be a red letter day, and a day on which you were expected to be in church. And sadly, because it always occurs on the 1st of November, it has fallen a bit into disuse. The church has finally realised that it should be transferred to the nearest Sunday so that we can remember the saints. And it's the gospel reading, as strange as it might seem at first reading, that points us in the right direction. This is a very poignant moment for Jesus. His friend has died and he wasn't with him at the end. And so it's not unnatural that Jesus is deeply moved, and John tells us that he was greatly disturbed. But we need to look at what he says to Martha, which is the nub of the story. She appears to be a little sceptical, perhaps even angry, as indeed all of us are often on the death of a loved one. And the response that Jesus gives her is perhaps not one that we might have expected. Did I not tell you, he says, that if you believed, you would see the glory of God? Yes, I suppose it's almost built into our psyche as Christians that we look forward to the life to come. But I get the sense that Jesus is suggesting that resurrection is not something which happens at some point in the future, but it's something that is here and now. Of course, we as Christians look forward to the life to come, but we live in the present. And the life of the saints is now. And our lives, lived as the saints, is what you and I are called to practice. But that, I suppose, poses another question, doesn't it? What is a saint? Well, one commentator has identified three categories. First of all, the notion that all of us are saints. The Greek word in the New Testament used for saint actually is better translated as holy one. And if you read the writings, particularly of St. Paul in the New Testament, you will see that he uses this word over and over again to refer to the Christians to whom he's writing. And these are ordinary people. They're living ordinary lives, but often in dangerous circumstances, persecuted by the Romans and reviled by the Jewish authorities, but nevertheless wholeheartedly committed to their beliefs and their faith. And the second category that he identifies is perhaps the one that is most familiar to us. These are the people that we find in the calendar of saints, and they're held up as special examples of life lived for Christ. But the danger with that is that we look at their pictures in books and in Bibles and in stained glass windows and get the wrong impression, because they're not classed as saints or superheroes. They too are ordinary men and women who demonstrate the same frailties as you and me, but overcome their weaknesses, often with great humour. As Robert Louis Stevenson once remarked, the saints are sinners who keep on going. Sinners who keep on going. One of my favourites is Saint Teresa of Avila. I'm sure I've told you this before, that she fell down in the mud and exclaimed, "No wonder you have so few friends, Lord, the way you treat them." But my particular favourite is St. John Bosco, who was a priest in Italy who did a huge amount for marginalised youths. It was while he was visiting prisons that Father Bosco noticed that the prisons were full of young lads between the ages of 12 and 18. And they were kept in appalling, deplorable conditions. And so he resolved that he would do whatever he could to stop others, boys of the same age, from ending up in that same place. And that organisation that he set up still exists today and is still a powerful force for young people. Apparently, his methods were quite unorthodox, and that led a lot of his fellow priests to recommend John to the insane asylum. And it said that priests came for him with horse and carriage, and he realised what their intentions were. So he politely waited as the two priests entered into the carriage. And when it was his turn to step up, he slammed the door, slapped the horse, and yelled to the carriage driver, "To the asylum, they're expected!" The third, and perhaps the most unexpected category that he identifies, are saints who are not yet born. Later this morning, I'm going to baptise young Bonnie, and we are going to welcome her into our church. Who knows what potential she has? Who knows what God might have in store for her? What work she might accomplish in his name? She could very well be a saint in the making. So there we have it. Saints of the past, saints of the present, and saints of the future. And so today, we thank God for all the saints who have gone before us and whose examples we cherish. We acknowledge those living who by their lives, their actions and their words are the saints of today. And we give thanks that there are yet more saints to come. Amen.
Amen.
Let us pray. Lord, make us instruments of your peace. Where there is hatred, let us sow love. Where there is injury, pardon. Where there is doubt, faith. Where there is despair, hope. Where there is darkness, light. and where there is sadness, joy. We ask this in Jesus' name. Amen. And so let us now stand and confess our own faith in the words of the Creed. We believe in one God, the Father, the Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, of all that is seen and unseen. We believe in one Lord Jesus Christ, the only Son of God, eternally begotten of the Father,
God,
light from light,
true God from true God,
begotten not made, of one being with the Father. Through him all things were made. For us and for our salvation he came down from heaven, was incarnate from the Holy Spirit and the Virgin Mary, and was made man. For our sake he was crucified under Pontius Pilate. He suffered death and was buried. On the third day he rose again in accordance with the Scriptures. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again in glory to judge the living and the dead, and his kingdom will have no end. We believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord, the giver of life, who proceeds from the Father and the Son, who with the Father and the Son is worshipped and glorified, who has spoken through the prophets. We believe in one holy, Catholic and apostolic church. We acknowledge one baptism for the forgiveness of sins. We look for the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come. Let us pray for the church and for the world, and let us thank God for his goodness.
Today, we join our prayers with all the saints in heaven, who are our great cloud of witnesses, interceding for us at the right hand of the Father. Let us now ask the Lord with renewed faith for the needs of our church and world. We pray for the church on earth. May the saints in heaven be an example for all Christians, that they may serve God in the way he wishes. We give thanks for the generations of Christian worship through the centuries in this place, for those who have been shining examples of faith and who have lived lives of witness in the community. As Father Brian has mentioned, we pray this morning for Bonnie Sugden, who is to be baptised here after the service. And we pray for her parents and godparents, that they may love her and cherish her as one of God's children. Lord, hear us.
Lord, graciously hear us.
We pray for peace on earth, that those in authority may follow the example of the saints who worked for peace and love. We hold before you, Lord, the meeting of world leaders in Glasgow, that there may be honesty and realism in their deliberations, and that they make as a priority action to preserve this world, wonderful, natural world, which you have given us to enjoy. Lord, hear us.
Lord, graciously hear us.
We pray for those in need and those who care, that they may see that in the saints who suffered the love of Christ for them. We pray for those who are sick, remembering especially Margaret Nicol, Richard Cook, Connie Fusher. We ask you to support those who see a little future for themselves, that they may find release from their fears. Lord, hear us.
Lord, graciously hear us.
We pray for those who have died in the hope of new life. May Christ bring them to share his glory with the saints. We give thanks for the life and witness of Rosemary Cartwright and Gordon Simpson. And we remember also those whose year's mind occurs around this time. Rest eternal, grant unto them, O Lord, and let light perpetually shine upon them.
May they rest in.
Lord, hear us.
Lord, graciously hear us.
God our Father, your saints have shown us how to be your Son's disciples. Following their example, we present our prayers in his name, as we say together, Merciful Father,
accept these prayers for the sake of your Son, our Saviour, Jesus Christ.
Would you please stand? Crying and pain are no more with the Lord, who brings peace to the hearts of those he's calling. His peace is freely offered. We need only to accept it. And so the peace of the Lord be always with you.
And also with you.
Giving him to be born of a woman and to die upon the cross. You raised him from the dead and exalted him to your right hand on high. Through him you have sent upon us your holy and life-giving Spirit and made us a people for your own possession. And now we give you thanks for the hope to which you call us in your Son, that following in the faith of all your saints, we may run with perseverance the race that is set before us, and with them receive the unfading crown of glory. Therefore, with angels and archangels, and with all the company of heaven, we proclaim your great and glorious name, forever praising you and singing. Saying, take, eat, this is my body which is given for you. Do this in remembrance of me. In the same way, after supper, he took the cup and gave you thanks. He gave it to them, saying, drink this, all of you. This is my blood of the new covenant, which is shed for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this as often as you drink it, in remembrance of me. Therefore, Heavenly Father, we remember his offering of himself made one for all upon the cross. We proclaim his mighty resurrection and glorious ascension. We look for the coming of your kingdom, and with this bread and this cup, we make the memorial of Christ, your Son, our Lord.
The mystery of faith.
Jesus Christ, our Lord.
Forever and ever.
taught us so, we pray.
Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory, forever and ever.
We break this bread to share in the body of Christ.
Though we are many, we are one body, because we all share in one bread.
Blessed are the clean of heart, for they shall see God. Blessed are the peacemakers, for they shall be called children of God. Blessed are they who are persecuted for the sake of righteousness, for theirs is the kingdom of heaven.
Thank you.
Let us remember those members of our congregation who are unable to be with us this morning and who may be enjoying our service from the comfort of their homes. Thanks be to you, Lord Jesus Christ, for all the benefits you have given us, for all the pains you have borne for us, since there are those from our church family who cannot now receive you sacramentally. We ask you to come spiritually into their hearts. O most merciful Redeemer, friend and brother, may they know you more clearly, love you more dearly, and follow you more nearly, day by day. Amen. God, the source of all holiness and giver of all good things, may we who have shared at this table as strangers and pilgrims here on earth be welcomed with all your saints to the heavenly feast on the day of your kingdom. Through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Let us pray. Almighty God, we thank you for feeding us with the body and blood of your Son, Jesus Christ. Through him we offer you our souls and bodies to be a living sacrifice. Send us out in the power of your Spirit to live and work to your praise and glory. Amen. Just a few notices this morning. Tuesday is All Souls Day, and there will be a Eucharist here at 9:30 in the morning. There are sheets at the back of the church. If there is anyone who you would like to be remembered by name at that service, can you please add them to the list at the back of the church? And I'd be really pleased if you could print those names. In the past, I've had to squint quite considerably to decide what some of the names say, so please do print the names. Secondly, we have found amongst the harvest Thanksgiving gifts a pair of glasses. We suspect that the person to whom they belong did not intend them as a harvest gift. So if you've lost a pair of glasses and feel embarrassed about it, you may come to me or the treasurer privately, and we will reunite you with your spectacles. Finally, I want to say a huge thank you to all those who in any way helped to provide for Rosemary's funeral on Friday. I know that Emma and Daniel were both quite overwhelmed with the kindness, the warmth of people, both who attended the funeral and who were able to attend, but perhaps who witnessed it on television, on the live stream. I'm told that actually it still could be viewed online for the next 30 days. There are some service booklets at the back of the church for anyone who perhaps watched the service or intends to online. I've not seen it and would like a copy of that, but please do take one, or take one away for anyone that you know who may have missed that viewing. And then just finally, and this might seem an odd thing to say, it did come to my attention that you know what rumours are like. Apparently, a rumour has gone around that the choir is riddled with COVID. Well, there might be riddled with a few things, but COVID isn't one of them. And it just goes to show, doesn't it? I mean, obviously, a couple of our congregations have COVID, but the choir are not, as we've demonstrated very clearly this morning. If you hear people putting rumours like that out, can you please disabuse them? Because it is really awful. It does upset people, especially those who feel vulnerable, that they may feel, I'm not going to church because the choir, in the past COVID, obviously, the congregation has got COVID, blah, blah, blah. It's not true. And the people who have COVID have behaved impeccably. They've done the right thing. Their heart, their husbands, wives, have isolated at the correct time. So we are as safe as we can be. And it's just annoying in the extreme that these sort of rumours persist. And it will have affected the number of people who turned up for Rosemary's funeral on Friday, which was very disappointing in that sense. Not that we didn't have a really good turnout, but it is important that we challenge people who say things like that. It's not true. And look at me. I speak to everybody. Have I got COVID?
No.
I test myself on a regular basis. As a priest, I've got to take a certain risk more than perhaps anybody else. So
We do want to continue the worship of the church in the way that it should be, and nobody should feel so vulnerable that they can't come to our service. Lecture over. That's how I think about it.
Completely, and the blessing of God Almighty, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit be upon each of you here this morning and with those whom you love, this day and always. Amen. Go in the peace of Christ.
Thanks be to God.